You have given an option of 4 or 5 services only, that's all.
I've put 10, 10 options.
10 options.
Yeah.
What is the reason of you preferring of foreign service, which is very difficult to find nowadays? I think I must be very few who is really opting as foreign service. Any specific reason?
It's the privilege of representing India at a global stage, and it also provides the opportunity to have discussions with distinguished people across the world on issues that pertain humans as a species in the 21st century, like migration, border management, terrorism, and climate change. It's just the having the privilege to have these discussions and the honor of representing India in a global stage. So,
can you tell me some 2-3 specific sort of attributes which Indian foreign service officers should have?
The most important attitude a foreign service officer must have is to have very good listening skills. He must be able to understand what his counterpart from another country is talking about, and he must have the analytical ability to read between the lines, and he must also have extremely good negotiation skills, and must be prepared to cede territory. He must know when to cede territory and when he must take territory. So that is a give and take policy. He must be very good at negotiations and a back and forth agreements between people. So,
if you have to put in only one word and 2 words each of the attributes, can you spell it?
Very good communication skills.
Okay.
Attention to detail.
Mm-hmm.
And also to be able to grasp what is happening in the world and be able to connect different events across the world and report back to in the Indian government here.
From your student years or from previous employment, and can you mention any incidents probably which justify that you have that attributes?
Sure, sir. For example, when I was working in Larsen & Toubro, I was entrusted with preparing the annual highlights document for my division, which is called the Buildings and Factories Division. This was a review by the chairman of L&T, and I had to prepare this collating all the details from around 100 departments from my division. So this required tremendous communication skills across various divisions, as well as the attention to detail from different lines of service in my division. For example, from procurement, from production, from safety, as well as finance. So,
but that is a very normal sort of a work of any of the jobs. Sort of thing.
I mean, I have the prior experience of having the attention to detail and be able to document what I come across at my work efficiently to ensure that the top management is happy. And in this instance, in the foreign service, it will be the government in Delhi.
How many languages do you know?
I know Tamil, and which is my mother tongue, and English, and I know how to read and write Hindi.
You have a, you know, able to pick up the language also, because that also might be required. Suppose you go to different places, different languages, you have knack of picking the language?
I am sure I will be able to adapt and learn quickly, sir.
Okay. Other than this thing, which foreign language probably you would like to learn first?
I've seen one or two French movies, so probably French is something I have a slight affinity towards.
Okay. Coming to more serious side of sort of diplomacy, suppose you are selected and at some point of time you have to make a presentation to the various other ambassadors or the representatives of the United Nations regarding India's case for United Security Council. So, permanent member. How you will be able to convince
them? India has been one of the most responsible countries when it comes to representations in United Nations.
You are making a presentation. Give 4 or 5 points.
Yes, sir. Certainly. Certainly, sir. So India is one of the first countries to pay the United Nations membership fees on time without any demand from United Nations. And India has contributed to tremendous peace across the world through deployment in the peacekeeping forces. And India has taken a lot of stands which are against terrorism, as well as to ensure security in the neighborhood as well as in the world stage. And India has historically not been part of any ideological bloc or any bloc which has threatened the peace and security of the world. So India is one of the countries which stands for peace, and it welcomes a lot of people from other countries with the tenet of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, and it's I believe it is time for India, being the third largest economy in the world in purchasing power parity terms, to be included in the Security Council.
Okay. Have you seen the this year budget?
Yes, sir, I have.
Okay. What strikes you most?
Sir, I feel that this budget is not a budget only for the next 12 months, but it provides a lot of structural reforms and is a budget which will have a lot of effect over the next 4 to 5 years.
Do you have any fixed deposits?
Yes, sir.
Whether it's helped in budget, something is there, whether it will help?
Fixed deposits, I feel, is almost a redundant form of investments for a person who is of my age.
Now my question is anything in the budget which talk about a fixed deposit?
Yes, sir, definitely the DICGC insurance, which was earlier there for up to 1 lakh for any deposit in a bank, has now been raised to 5 lakhs, so which is a great relief for a lot of depositors.
Where you have studied actually? Which college?
I did a distance education from University of Madras, and I pursued my chartered accountancy course side by side.
Okay. What do you think of JNU agitation recently? I think there was quite a
sir, I think
bit of agitation is happening in JNU. What do you feel the students' participation in such type of agitations?
I think it's extremely important for a populace like India, which is a democracy for the last 70 years, for the people to have the right as well as the privilege to dissent about the government's decisions. I think dissent is one of the bedrocks of democracy, and it actually strengthens the policies of a government when there is immediate feedback from the people, because the government has to realize that all the policies which are being passed are ultimately for the people's benefit, and if the people, a section of the people, feel that it is not working for them, I think the government must be cognizant of this fact. And I believe the JNU protests definitely highlight the fact that there are some concerns with regard to certain legislations and certain policies of the government, and I believe the government will do a course correction to correct their stand.
So you are in favor of such, you know, protests being in the education institution, university? You are in favor of it?
Non-violent protests.
Non-violent?
Yes.
There has been some violence also there?
That I primarily believe that is because of the inclusion of some anti-social elements who are, I don't know if they are part of the university or if they are been brought from outside, but per se I think the students are very non-violent, and the protests start off very peacefully with them airing their views, but somewhere down the line, after a week or so, some of these anti-social elements, they come into the university and they chant slogans and they go on a violent spree, and I think that's where the situation gets out of control and then the government has to intervene.
Okay.
You're interested in foreign service?
Yes, sir.
You have read anything on diplomacy?
I have read during the course of my preparation only.
Okay. Those who are not with us are against us. Sorry? Have you heard of this doctrine? Those who are not with us are against us.
I have not heard of this doctrine, sir.
Okay. So you have not heard of this. This is called John Foster Dulles doctrine. This was the most dominant part of US foreign policy towards the non-aligned world. Okay, you have not read it? Okay, it's all right. Why India did not join the BRI?
The Belt and Road Initiative was China's initiative to connect, go back to the old Silk Route connectivity between China and Europe as well as Asia. But India has certain concerns regarding this BRI, primarily because the CPEC corridor, which passes between the Xinjiang province connecting the Gwadar port in Pakistan, flows through the Gilgit-Baltistan territory of India, which is currently occupied by Pakistan. And since it has an effect on the internal sovereignty of India, we are against the BRI. And moreover, the economic model of the BRI sees China contributing a top-down approach towards the development of all the projects, where they deploy their personnel as well as they give loans at very high rates of interest, in such a way that some of the countries which cooperate with the BRI, they go into a debt trap. So India feels that there needs to be more transparency and a greater call for respecting sovereignty of other nations.
What is that China-Pakistan economic corridor you just mentioned? What is that?
It is a connection between the Xinjiang province of China as well as the Gwadar port.
Xinjiang province.
the Xinjiang province of China to Gwadar.
Xinjiang province.
Yes, sir. Xinjiang province of China to Gwadar port in Pakistan, which goes through the Gilgit-Baltistan territory of India, which is currently occupied by Pakistan, sir.
So it is on disputed territory.
Yes, the Gilgit-Baltistan portion is disputed.
In 1963, on 2nd March, Pakistan transferred 6,000 square kilometers to China. You are aware of that?
I believe that is on
Sakasgam Valley.
Yes, sir.
Biggest of them is Sakasgam. So this was transported. So this passes through that. But in the agreement, there was a clause that China will renegotiate this whenever the sovereignty issue is decided. So that clause is absent here now. That's the main reason.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What are the other reasons?
Primary.
What are the environmental reasons?
I believe that the corridor.
Many interest organizations. Many interest organizations have objected to the object on the ground of environmental reasons.
Yes, it has.
Ecology.
It has quite a debilitating impact on the biodiversity of the region, considering that it is in the region of the Himalayas as well as the Pamir Knot, where a lot of these mountain ranges meet. And considering the fact that the mountain ecosystem is one that is is facing considerable stress because of climate change, and a lot of the roads have to be laid by blasting the mountains, it does not make a lot of sense environmentally. There is problems sustainability.
What is the greatest diplomatic problem of the world today?
Sir,
which issue is known as the diplomat's nightmare? Which issue?
So there are certain land issues. For example, the Israel-Palestine issue is a long-standing issue which has not been resolved. Similarly, the Kashmir issue between India and Pakistan is
no. Kashmir issue is not there. Israel-Palestine issue is the number one, which is known as diplomat's nightmare.
Yes, sir.
Tell me about the issue.
So what happened was because of the world wars which happened in the 20th century, the region which is Israel right now was owned by British and the French. And considering the decolonization which took place, Britain and France wanted to exit the country and gave the territory back to the Jews after the Second World War. And the Jews, having been persecuted in the Second World War, felt that that was their sacred land and wanted to resettle over there. But that territory was actually occupied by a lot of the Arabs who had stayed there for thousands of years. So now the territory became disputed between the Arabs who have stayed there for thousands of years and the Israelis who feel that it's their sacred land. So this is the reason why UN felt
1947,
that
what happened? 1947 November, what happened?
That is when the Israelis settled in the land which is called Israel right now, and the Palestinians were driven away to West Bank and to the Gaza.
In 1947 November, the United Nations organization itself,
yes,
by resolution number 181, divided the territory.
Yes, sir.
One is the Jews, the other is the Arabs.
It's the two states.
That really started the problems.
Yes, sir.
But now again they are celebrating the year of celebrating against this, that this should not have been divided. So what is the latest status?
The latest status is the US president has provided a deal whereby he divides the entire land of Israel between the Palestinians and the Israelis in cognizance of the two
states. What about the capital?
The capital for the Israelis will continue to be Jerusalem, whereas for the Palestinians, there a $50 billion grant is to be provided to build a new city east of Jerusalem, sir, a new city.
Presently, what is the capital of Palestine?
They consider Jerusalem as their capital.
Ramallah.
Yes.
Ramallah is where is Ramallah?
Yes.
It is 10 kilometers away from Jerusalem. Oh, yes. Very near. Yes. So now they are saying that the eastern part you will be having.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. You did your financing and accounting and you had a lot of experience in documentation. According to the recent reports and NSSO survey, it seems that unemployment has tanked to the 45-year high and consumption has dropped to so much of levels, and the finance ministers claim that the nominal GDP growth would be 10%. Do you agree with it? If agree, why? If you are not agreeing, you substantiate both these.
But I think it is a well-known fact that unemployment has risen in the recent past, primarily on account of a downturn in the global economic scenario, which has permeated even into India. And this has resulted in the GDP slowing down to, I believe, 4.5% in Q3 of this year. And so India is faced with a serious problem of a transient economic slowdown. This is more of a structural as well as an issue with the consumer demand in the economy. So the budget which was presented this year has certainly looked to address a certain portions of this. I believe the finance minister has acknowledged that there has been a significant downturn, because she has allocated quite a lot of government expenditures to boosting demand in the economy, so much so that they are ready to accept a fiscal slippage of 3.8% this year and a targeted slippage of 3.5% next year, which is beyond the FRBM recommendations. And moreover, the allocations to MNREGA has also been increased this year to around 61,500 crores, which is definitely going to boost the rural demand, as well as there have been quite a lot of incentives and tax swaps provided to the MSMEs, which is going to improve the rural manufacturing scenario. So I feel the downturn will come out because of some of the measures which have been provided in this budget, as well as the structural reforms which have been provided, which will happen over the next 4 to 5 years.
Provide me a straight answer. Do you think we can achieve nominal GDP of 10% or not?
Definitely we can achieve a nominal GDP of 10%, because inflation currently is around 7%, and the RBI mandate is a plus or minus 2 beyond the 4% criteria. So assuming that we are happy with an inflation of 5 to 5.5%, I think a GDP growth of 4.5 to 5% is certainly achievable.
According to golden tenets of taxation, direct taxation, what we get from direct taxation should be higher than indirect taxation. What do you think about the recent corporate tax cut which costed 1.5 lakh crore to the exchequer? Whether it's a well thought and robust move from the government?
So currently the direct tax portion of the total revenue of the government is 54%, and compared to the indirect tax of 46%. And I believe the total reduction in the corporate tax rates which happened was primarily to ensure that more money is in the hands of the companies. That is, their disposable income will be greater and they will invest more of it in the economy, which will help in generating more jobs as well as manufacturing in greater quantities to import to increase the exports. So I believe though there is a fiscal slippage of 1.4 lakh crore this year and it will continue to be there in the next years, I believe it's a very good decision considering the fact that we are in a significant economic downturn and we need certain demand side improvements, like fiscal improvements, like cutting of taxes to spur demand in the economy.
With inequality rocketing like anything, and Oxfam pointing that in most of the wealth is concentrated with certain people, while we give corporate tax cuts, does not it result in more inequality escalating like anything, and redistribution is taken to the back burner?
I beg to differ on this particular point of view, sir. I feel if there is a reduction in the tax rates for the companies, it will definitely trickle down to a lot of the people who are being employed in the companies. So more money in the hands of the company would mean that they will invest more in manufacturing, which will employ more number of people. And if more number of people are employed, they have more employment opportunities. So
in India is more of what kind of economy? Which sector dominates Indian economy?
Service sector.
Number of people employed more?
Agriculture.
And how about which gives maximum employment, whether it's manufacturing or agriculture? I mean, the terms of per capita amount to invest and the people, number of people employed, whether it is manufacturing or agriculture?
Agriculture sector.
And
so the tax rates are happening in the manufacturing sector because the agriculture sector is completely out of the income tax regime. Mm-hmm. So there need not be any tax rate cut for the agricultural sector to boost their growth.
So do you think the focus should have been more on agriculture rather than corporate?
Definitely the focus should be on agriculture, and it is in the current budget, where there's a 16-point agenda for growth of agriculture and to double the farmers' income in the next 3 years. In addition to this, it is also the bounden duty of the government to improve the manufacturing sector, because it contributes almost 25% of GDP. And it is also very important to note that China, when they grew from a manufacturing sector and they made the transition to a service sector. So it's also very important to support the manufacturing
sector. Does MSMEs pay corporate tax in India?
Yes, sir, they do.
How much they pay?
I'm not too sure of the rate, but they get a lot of tax incentives.
Okay. And tell me about this. What is this Uttarameru? What is its significance in Indian history? Uttarameru.
I'm not aware of this.
Okay. How did Tanjore, from being a bedrock of feudalism, it became a bustling economy? It was a bedrock of feudalism in 1900s and 1950s. Few landlords used to dominate, then it became a bustling agrarian economy. What were the reasons to it?
Tanjavur is the rice bowl of Tamil Nadu, and it has the major river Kaveri, which is flowing in it. And considering that independent India, there were a lot of land reforms which happened, a lot of land distribution happened to a lot of the farmers. And so once they had land in their hands, they were able to grow using the some of the green revolution techniques were also introduced in Tamil Nadu. And considering this fact, the economic fortunes of the people became better.
I have a few questions with regards to, you were mentioning about the negotiations related to environmental issues, which would be the priority if you are in the position to represent India. So I want to get your opinion about the labeling of the products or the manufactured goods to the trade, like eco-labeling or the silk mark. How are these going to impact the trade?
So labeling provides more reliability on the product that is being consumed. For example, an FSSAI mark on a particular product or a BIS mark on a particular product will ensure that quality of the product is not compromised and it's of the highest quality. So for example, between India and the European Union, the trade agreement has stalled primarily because of some of these quality issues. So if there is greater labeling of products, it would mean that the trade agreement can be concluded between India and European Union, which would help our exporters as well as to get key imports into India to further our manufacturing. So labeling is definitely provides greater quality control and consciousness for the products which is being traded on.
But the labeling is by the Indian regulator.
Yes.
So the Indian regulatory standards are being accepted globally.
We have signed some.
Are we matching up to the global standards so that our regulators quality analysis or everything is getting accepted at the global picture?
There have been some concerns regarding the products which have been exported from India to Europe. For example, there was a consignment of some goods in Italy which was returned, as well as some of our textile products nowadays, there is a sense of greater rejection percentage. So I believe, yes, the regulatory mechanism in India has a lot that can be improved, but I believe we have the mechanisms in place, and it requires greater implementation of the laws and a greater focus and investment into ensuring the best quality products are certified.
Can you think of any international labeling which helps our trade?
Ma'am, there is this agricultural labeling called HV. Okay. I'm not too sure of the name. It's called HVAV or something.
Irrespective of whether it's a cultivable or manufactured or of any of the finished or a byproduct, any other thing?
The ISO mandate is International Standards Organization, and we have the Indian variant as well.
What about this GI?
Yes, GI is from the...
Is it given in the Indian scenario or the... Who does give this?
GI tag is given based on the convergence with the TRIPS agreement of... I believe it's WIPO. It's given by them, and we have around more than 350 products from India which are certified to be GI, so which definitely helps in improving the quality as well as gives recognition to some of these indigenous products to be sold globally.
Have you heard of this labeling called as Bhog?
No, ma'am, I haven't come across.
So please go through it. It's from the food standards, Bhog, BHOG. What is your take on the budgeting given to attain the sustainable development goals? Is it only the budgeting which a nation should invest on its own SDG to be achieved, or is it a global...
The SDG goals are universal goals. For example, the goal of zero hunger, it does not mean zero hunger only for India. It means that India must contribute to ensure that even global hunger has been eradicated. So definitely our contributions to SDG are seen in this budget, where there is where we are talking about economic development as well as aspirational India.
No, I am not asking about our budgeting. I am asking about the overall budgeting. Are we also contributing in terms of aid as a donor to any of the receptor countries? Are we in this? Are we?
Yes, yes, ma'am. We are contributing towards this, and we are also doing our own bit for climate change as well.
Mm-hmm.
It also forms part of the SDG goals. We have already prepared the nationally determined contributions, and we are helping some of these Pacific Ocean islands as well to prepare their own nationally determined contributions.
Mm-hmm.
And we are contributing copiously to UNESCO as well as UNICEF to ensure that there's greater education as well as women attainment in the world, ma'am.
Have you heard of the recent discussion from the UNESCO about Save the Seasons?
I've not come across.
There has been a debate about saving the seasons. No?
I have not come across this, ma'am.
Okay. There has been a discussion with regards to whether, along with the other heritage spots, should we include the geoclimatic issues, which are not continuing to retain at the same level.
Yes, ma'am.
To also be included as one of the geo-heritage things.
Yes,
to go through about the Save the Seasons. Yeah.
All right, Mr. Prasad. So, if you look at the recent trends, and there is a move to against globalization, there is a lot of protectionism, xenophobia, the kind of pitch on which Trump has won the elections, or Boris Johnson, or Brexit. So that is on the one side. And the world now requires more globalized world to face the challenges of climate change and diseases. Don't you think it's a contradiction, and what is your...
I think that is the tragedy of our times, that when the time is most important for us to get together, we are having a lot of the right-wing nationalism as well as xenophobia, which we are seeing, this has been erupted in different parts of the world. On one hand, we are seeing the Amazon rainforest and the Australian wildfires, but we are seeing the heads of those countries stating that it's not because of climate change, or they don't accept that climate change has happened. So I think it requires greater acknowledgement of the fact that climate change is a reality, or we are facing different nationalist problems where people are becoming overtly nationalist or want to protect their own countries at the cost of global.
Sorry, you're just commenting on what exactly it is. My question is, what is your view in terms of what solutions do we have? How do we solve this problem?
So it requires greater convergence over issues. For example, we have the Conference of Parties for Climate Change, where all the countries get together and they have acknowledged that $100 billion will be contributed to the Green Climate Fund. So we need, all the countries need to get this working.
When you have all these countries coming together, they're looking for the lowest commonest denominator for agreement. And many major countries are not involved.
Yes, sir.
So again, this is not solving the problem.
I feel the only solution towards solving a global problem is to get all the people in the world to agree. I feel a single country which is waging a war against all the other countries for a global issue is not going to be very sustainable in the long run, sir. So I think that there needs to be greater convergence on the issues.
So if I say that to solve the globalized problem at the global level, we need to start intervention at the local level. I think that would be right.
Yes, local level, as in we need to get each country's people invested in the country's viewpoint. For example, if India has a viewpoint regarding any particular issue of the world, it is bound on duty of the Indian government to get all the local governments to support it as well.
Again, it is going to
domestic policy will need to align with the foreign policy.
Again, if you say the domestic policy need to be aligned with the global policy, and the globalized world does not need that kind of xenophobic or nationalistic ideology, then again we are not reaching any consensus.
I think the only way to reach a consensus is through issue-based negotiations and convergence over issues. I feel that is the only way we can come together.
Have you thought about these things?
I've been reading in some news channels, the news reports.
Oh, we are aware of these things, but yes. Have you thought about it?
I think I'm in the process.
Yeah. You should start thinking, because this is critical areas, and India being a big country, as a important say, and you representing the country,
yes,
definitely like to have a view. You have mentioned reading fiction.
Yes, sir.
English fiction.
English.
Name three writers you have read with the name of the book.
Sure. Recently, I've read Kazuo Ishiguro books. I've read his Booker Prize winner, Remains of the Day. I've read Julian Barnes's Sense of an Ending, which won the 2011 Booker Prize. And recently I also read Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, sir.
Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, what is the premise?
The premise is it's a crisis of conscience situation where a person commits a crime out of the poverty he is, and the entire book bases how his guilt comes out and how the character moves from being where he justifies his crime because of the social situation he is in to ultimately facing the punishment for his crime. It comes a complete full arc.
So it is basically a psychology of...
Yes, sir.
Any other books of Dostoevsky?
I am going to read Brothers Karamazov, but it's a long book. I need some time to be invested in it, sir.
The choices of books are pretty good. Excellent. Did Ishikoro won the Nobel Prize?
He won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 2017.
Okay. What is Tobin tax and what is your view on Tobin tax?
I'm not aware of Tobin tax.
Should the financial transaction be taxed? In fact, that has been discussed in European Union.
Financial transactions are taxed currently in India in the form of the securities transaction tax, where there is a...
International level. Of course, let me clarify. It is an international transaction. Particularly of speculative nature.
Speculation. Yes, definitely. I feel that is a great avenue from where we can raise a lot of money for addressing real social issues on the ground. For example, Bernie Sanders in the US presidential
election. No, all that is not the part of the question which I asked. I'm saying this has been discussed for the last 20 years, Tobin tax. Every time we have Tobin tax. But nothing is happening, number one. Number two, even Europe started discussing last month. Major countries like Italy and Spain are against it. What is the issue here?
The issue is primarily because some of the larger companies in the world, they end up paying zero tax, and though they are, the market capitalization is the highest and they make so much of revenue and they give employment to a lot of people, they don't end up paying any tax because they route a lot of money through a lot of these shell and dormant companies, and they take advantage of these tax agreements between in a lot of these tax havens.
Instead of looking to the member who is asking, you can look to the whole board.
Yes, sir.
At least to the chair. But you are just focusing on him. Okay.
Yeah. So, think about it.
You have mentioned as you, yep, as a hobby, playing football.
Yes, sir.
You are a supporter of which club?
Liverpool.
Why?
It was the team that I watched at the beginning, and all my friends were supporters of Manchester United. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to support Liverpool just to spite them. So.
Because this is. This year coming on tops, probably that's why
you have... I've been following since 2002, so it's been almost 17 years of pain, and it's only this year that there is some kind of return on my investment.
So. Which role do you like more as footballer, defender or, you know?
I'm a goalkeeper, sir. So,
a goalkeeper.
yeah, so I like my role the most.
Oh, I see. So probably, what sort of message you get out of a football game?
I think the greatest learning in football is that the entire team has to play as a team, and an individual cannot perform by himself, and it has to be a collective effort to win the game. So I think that is the ultimate learning.
Do you think the goalkeeper would be a good leader in football team?
Definitely in football, I feel a lot of the leadership and management comes from the coach, who decides what kind of position a player plays, who has to be picked in a team, and what are the tactics to be used. Captain on the field or a leader on the field is one who shepherds the entire team. And I feel the goalkeeper definitely has the ability and the capabilities to do it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Have you heard of Albert Camus?
Yes, sir. He's a French writer. He's written
The Strange. He's a Nobel laureate.
Sir? He's a Nobel laureate.
In what position he was playing for the World Cup?
I don't know.
You are the only Nobel laureate who was playing for the World Cup football. Okay. You are the goalkeeper of Algeria. You born in Algeria.
Ah, yes, yes.
Maybe I think we will call you for after a minute.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Give some debriefing on this.
Oh, sure. Thank you.
In general, you did well, but there are certain issues we thought probably we can highlight to you, actually. I think, first of all, I think when you enter, maybe I think it's the place and all that. You know, very, very small things.
Perfect.
When you come in, that you have to see that properly, and then wishing and all.
Yes.
And Also, your eye contact was a big issue, actually, whole interview. You have been only looking at the person who is asking the question, which is basically is not correct. Because all others are watching to you. If you don't look at others, at least you look at the chairman. Once in a while to other members also. Because they are listening and whatever answer you are giving, it is not you're only answering to one member.
Okay.
That I think there's a whole interview was noticed. And you have to be precise actually. What question is asked, I think you are giving very long answers, actually. And also when you're giving answers, you are quite unnecessarily, I think either your terms you are using or explanations you are giving, which is not called for. Actually, he even once twice interrupted you also. I deliberately didn't do it. I said, okay, let's listen. And when you started, even that time you started saying certain sort of, you know, about yourself that I learned like this. This immediately brought me to, I was not thinking of what question I'm going to ask. Since you are talking about that, this sort of, that's why I asked about the attributes and all that. So it means that whatever you are saying, you have to be careful and all that. Sometimes what will happen is that you will utter something and then lead to the question, you will not able to properly handle it. So I think be precise. That's the other important thing. As far as the content of your answer is concerned, I would say it's okay, it's good, but many questions still you are not good. I think like 2-3 times, 4 times, I think it's fine. I mean, well, you can say that I am not aware. I think number of questions you also already mentioned, particularly I think when both of them were asking. Though the question was basically asked on the various sort of subjects, but more was concentrated on foreigners because you have made a first preference. So there's a likelihood because you have given the first preference. Even there also, I think the little try to have little more idea about the foreign affairs and all that. Because whatever he was asking was a very fundamental sort of a thing which he should really...
And you have committed the greatest mistake. Never repeat that mistake. Mm. When I asked you what is the greatest diplomatic problem in the world, you told Palestinian, then told Kashmir. Mm. India is frantically trying to prevent that. Pakistan is trying to do that.
But that was so a
never
disaster.
Never Kashmir with Palestine.
Because...
Never do that.
Because that is, you know... You must have listening that India is strongly objecting anything anybody would talk about Kashmir.
Also, in the South Arabia, they have bargained because of the Malaysian Muslim meeting.
Why?
They had objected. Pakistan said, I will not go there because if you have hold a meeting in Kashmir, meeting on Kashmir. Then yesterday, Saudi Arabia said, somehow he is going back on his promise that on Kashmir, we will not hold a meeting now. So they have snubbed Pakistan now. So India is frantically trying to equate Kashmir with Palestine. Pakistan is trying. India is frantically trying to prevent that. Okay. So never commit this mistake if you are going to have Indian Foreign Service.
Yes, sir.
But this is the very basic thing of Indian diplomacy. Okay.
So bilateral issue.
Yeah.
I think the best is that probably I think just try to do little bit practice. Like some of the questions which has been asked, or you might be attending another mock, or whatever your biodata. These are likely questions, and particularly in foreign service. Prepare yourself answers, and you see that whether you are really exceeding beyond a point really what question is asked. And
yes,
try to make it precise and concise. And also, I would suggest a little bit, you give answer also in front of mirror. It will improve you actually, because I think certain things like your gestures and all that, or looking at the things, you know, that may improve actually. It's not a very great driver, but sometimes it's a really important sort of thing. I think any session you can repose.
When chairman asked you what language would you like to learn for service, you see, it's a very, very difficult question. It is based upon so much of knowledge. First thing, France had 12 colonies in Africa, which were all got independence in 1962. So with French language, English though you are learning, French, you can cover the whole of Africa.
Francophone.
Whole of South America is Spanish, except Brazil. Brazil is the only country which talks
Portuguese.
So with the Spanish, you can cover the whole of Latin America. So they are the two languages by which you can cover 70-80% of the world.
Because what has happened, as rightly pointed by him, you few things on foreign service to preference. Probably it became little slightly.
They are worse. They cannot use
Though it was simple question language, it was trying to find it out what is your mind actually.
You dealt it very fickly. It was fickle.
I mean, it's nothing to get discouraged, I tell you. Nothing to get discouraged. many things you had done, I think a lot of plus points were there. You were able to have give good answers.
No, sir, I thought if I say one particular language, it will mean like I'm taking a stand.
No, no, what he is mentioning to you, there's certain sort of language which is, you know, widely spoken, and even you see, United Nations, what are the languages really there, which is much more common and all that.
Yeah, yeah.
So, the question was very small question, but it was I was trying to judge whether you are really looking at in wider perspective that what really is a foreign service officer should have actually.
And the reason you gave, no? You said watching the made it sound fickle. Exact wording was that only.
I don't know what to say, which language.
No, 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 then you
since your first choice is foreign services, your
questions would be more focused.
Maybe
your answer need to be based on certain logic.
Certain logic.
I could cover the maximum population.
Like I said, no, I would like to learn Spanish because it's is much, much more really known. English, any case, you are aware. So, which is the second language you will see? Definitely, you are not going to say Chinese and all that, of course, Chinese. So, I think you think of that lines actually. But I think a lot of plus points, I think you are quite confident. Otherwise, I think you are giving, logically, you are giving answer.
I am beating around the bush, I know it. But that problem is because I don't know. I don't know the answers. It's just...
one or two questions,
I mean,
think
the main answer I can think and write over 5 or 6 minutes. Point is, I don't know the answers.
But I think one or two questions was little bluffing also.
Yeah,
actually,
that's what.
Like when she asked the SDGs, this was purely bluffing. You are really.
Yeah, I was clearly visible that you are not aware. India doesn't give any budgeting to any of these countries.
One of the great techniques of interview is how do you handle the question which you do not know, which you know you will all call, you will all speak. How to handle that question?
Answer could have been because you are not knowing the SDG. You could have said something about SDG. I said, I am not sure whether India is really. This was a simple answer. You have to be honest.
It was clear that.
See, you are already knowledgeable. That is why you are here. And secondly, probably because you worked in corporate 5 years, the perspective is entirely different. This is very formal in the sense. So when I am asking or when the panel member is asking, you are supposed to keep quiet. You don't interrupt.
Lot of things you said, why even describe your word accounting, this, blah. So questions are being really immediately asked. Suppose if you are very sure that you have to answer that, otherwise you have to be precise.
And one way of doing is that once the question is asked, you take a pause of 5 to 6 seconds and then answer. Whenever you are confident, you immediately jumping the bandwagon. Otherwise you start saying something. You can pause about it, think about it, what can the word or what can I answer. Doesn't matter because 6 seconds is very short span. But you can think about the line and course of action which you should go. Because you are immediately answering, no, because you want to be prompt and spontaneous, sometimes you miss the entire question. That's the thing.
Yeah. When is your interview?
50th.
Good this time. Okay, all the best to you.
Okay. And it would be fine.
I think go positive, be confident and you will do well.
Last week, I think on Jan 26, you did your interview.
Yeah, you were there in my panel.
Yeah. You were much, much better.
Then.
Yeah.
What you don't know.
Yeah. I was there and he was much better during the best candidate in that entire set was.
Maybe today you were a bit nervous.
No, nervous. I didn't know many of the answers.
That's the reason.
So you're really difficult. As a responder, what you don't know, please don't create answers. That will go really against.
No, but then sir is saying if I told don't know to many
questions. No. See, I'm saying that you should have that much knowledge. See, 3-4 times you are not able to know, but if so 50% of questions say I'm not, that is also going to be bad really. What I'm saying is try to induce your knowledge. Wherever your weak things are there, brush up your knowledge. That's what I'm saying. Because basically it is, you know, it is more of a sort of personality. It is not going to test totally also only on you and your whatever facts and figures. But basic things you are required to know. So what I'm saying is that you should ought to know few things actually.
So and JNU didn't have a major issue related to CAA.
I didn't touch upon.
Yeah.
Actually, it was more on the hostel issue and other issues actually.
The hike and the internal issues between right and left. That was the issue. You went
Jamia
into.
Jamia had more. Sort
yeah. Of Jamia had the other issue. JNU didn't have an issue related to CAA. It had a label of fee hike. We are not sure whether it is also because of CAA. So it's between the internal students, the ABVP and the left group were the ones which created. And sir was focusing on the violence in the campuses. That was his major interest towards. So you were into the students have the right to give their...
Actually, I was not getting into argument with you. I was just trying to check on the various fields that what I wanted to know.
Wherever you are comfortable, no, you are very articulate. You,
yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
That is for sure. That's what we are telling.
Yeah, that
is for sure. So just wherever you are not sure, you try to be... Don't bluff, that's what. Don't create answers from thin air.
Okay.
That would help you a lot. Otherwise, you are totally...
But what do I do if I don't know 50%?
No, it won't happen.
It won't happen.
It won't happen.
Also, this happened four times. This time, in this one, four times happened. Four times.
No, yeah. Four times I didn't know, but I bluffed many questions. So, which meant I didn't know 50%.
That's what I'm saying. Probably would have added. It's fine. I mean, actually, I think this particular what interview I took, actually, there were a lot of questions we asked, actually.
Mm.
Not necessarily we would have asked questions. Because why this is a mock interview? Basically, I think in mock interview, we ask more questions. The reason is try to see that where is your strength and weakness is to tell you. In actual interview, it may not be that much questions are going to be asked actually.
I had 13 questions in my interview where I scored 190. 13, that's it.
Okay.
For 40 minutes.
So then I'm saying,
so it was less
questions.
So does it mean I have to speak more?
No. See, don't.
You're speaking more.
More. You're speaking
you're
more.
Speaking
right?
More.
No, no, no. The thing is that, If you start speaking more, you are giving a lot many leads to them.
Yeah.
Then what it may land up is that he may be knowing much, much more than you in that subject. And he may think you are bluffing more.
Yeah.
And
actually, whatever you said, I tell you what percentage has gone into whatever you said. At least whatever question he asked, except JNU and one on budget, all was whatever you have been saying. 50% what he asked was from you. 25% counting other things is from whatever you have said.
Yeah.
One or two question answer from you. So I would say about 50 to 60% your interview went whatever you uttered.
Because my questions came from your point only. It was you told negotiations related to climate change and environmental issues. So I thought, okay, you have an interest towards that. So you must be aware of what should be economically linked to the environmental issue.
You would be wondering why I'm asking Uttarameru. It is related to Tanjavur. Chola inscription on local self-government. It is in NCRT. And this is the 1000, I think, Rajaraja temple is celebrating its grandeur. So, because it were somewhere I fought Tanjavur in the start itself, two times it's coming, so I asked.
Okay, Mr. Prasad, all the best to you. So, be positive. I think you have a very, very good chance.
Good. Last time we gave you the highest